I am trying to get through in my remaining years of life. I have been a public servant, a civil servant with the government of India for 2.5 decades. And suddenly I have now, not suddenly, actually, it was planned, I have taken a jump and joined the academic world. And I am discovering the freedom, the challenges, the opportunity this offers for somebody like me. So today I am here to actually talk a little bit about Nepal. But I must confess, I am not an expert on Nepal. Perhaps I know a little more about my country, but then there's so much common between the countries of the region that what is true of India is also perhaps true of Nepal. What is true of Nepal is also perhaps true of India, of Bangladesh, of Sri Lanka, Pakistan. And so I want to share some thoughts on that. But a larger part of what can Nepal realize its potential anytime soon, I'm going to keep it on board till tomorrow, because I'm going to give a talk also at and be part of a panel discussion at an event organized by the Nepal Economic Forum tomorrow at Hotel Shangri-La. I hope you. But I'm going to talk a little bit about that today as well. What I want to talk about more centrally today is about the discipline of public policy. And in that sense, I want to answer four questions before I go to the issues related to Nepal and Nepal's development process. What is public policy? The second question is, as a discipline, why is it distinct? And more importantly, why is this discipline important for you people, for people of your age in our country? In other words, why it is important for a country like Nepal and a country like India at this juncture in our history? The third question is, what are the public policy challenges in Nepal, which is what relates to the theme that I am supposed to speak here of. So let me start by saying, what is public policy all about? Public policy is basically about making our lives better. It is about changing the way we work, the way we live, the way we engage socially, for the objective of improving human well-being. It is about giving a shape to society's aspirations. That is what public policy is about. Normally, we look at public policy in a very confined, narrow manner. We think of public policy as the job being done by government. But that is not exactly right. Yes, large part of public policy is the domain of the government. But public policy is about all of us. It is about what we need to do to make our lives different, to make our society what we would like it to be over time, to help in its evolution, to take it where we would like to be ourselves. Because our own individual outcomes, professional, social, or otherwise, are actually closely tied with what happens in our society. It is the collective evolution of the society which will also give us the means to move forward individually as professionals, as people, as citizens of nations in this part of the world. You must also be wondering why this person, I'm basically an economist by training, coming and lecturing to management students. Well, all this is about management. It is about managing our public resources. It is about managing our aspirations. It is about managing the delivery of those public goods for which we create governments. Governments exist because they have to provide the public goods. And what are the public goods? Well, they are roads, they are bridges, they are defense, they are telecom services. They are also about public goods, are also about good policies. So government exists because we need policy. We need an agency to provide us with a framework that helps us realize our individual aspirations. So it is as much public policy, is as much about, is it just good? Not working? Something wrong? Okay, it doesn't matter why they fix it. So public policy is as much about economics, about management, about political science, about ethics,
about philosophy, about literature. It is truly multidisciplinary subject which tries to seek a balance between theory and practice. But unlike other subjects, it is largely practice oriented. So that's one of the distinctions about public policy. Why is it important for us at this juncture of our national lives? I don't know whether you've heard of the term demographic transition and demographic dividend. Have you? Yes or no?
No.
Okay. Countries in this part of our world, countries like Nepal, countries like India, we are going through a major demographic transition which happens once in the lifetime of a nation. And it is happening right now for countries in this region. What does this transition mean? It means that the profile of our population is changing in a manner that it is potentially very useful to create an atmosphere, to create a platform for rapid transformation of the society. Now, why does that happen? Oh, it is there. So let me use the pictures rather than this picture on the left. I draw your attention. So I'm talking about the demographic transition. What you would have heard the phrase Nepal is a young nation or India is a young nation. What does it mean? It means that an average Nepalese in 2020 is going to be about 25 years old. An average Indian in 2020 is going to be about 28 years old. An average Chinese in 2020 is going to be about 45 or 48 years old. An average Japanese is going to be 54 years old. What does it mean? That the age profile of the nation is changing. Now if you look at this picture here, the bottom, this is 1950, this is 2050. It's a 100 year span and it is showing what is happening in the demographic profile of Nepal. This blue shape is the proportion of children in the population. Children in the age group 0 to 14 years. This green one here is proportion of elderly in the population. Now, if you take the green and the blue together, what do you get? You get the proportion of those in the population who are dependent on others. Who are the others? Others are this red block. These are the working age population. This is the population in the age group 15 to 64. Now, what is happening in Nepal and what is happening in India, you will see the next slide is, you can find, this is roughly around 1990. This point is around 1990. So what do you find? There is a huge increase in the population in the age group 15 and 64. Which means the working age population is expanding. That is expanding because of what has happened to the birth rates and death rates earlier. But the point is that this huge mass of people is the ticket to development, if we get it right. Why I say ticket to development? Often we are told that, you know, countries like India have no future, or have been told in the past, or countries like Nepal or Bangladesh don't have future, especially by the Western practitioners of development and political science or political economy. Why do they say? They say these are overpopulous nations and they have no future. But what is now happening is this very resource, I call it a resource and not a constraint on our development process, a potential resource which can actually transform our societies and our economies very rapidly. And how will that happen? It will happen if we get our policy environments right. Because this mass to become a resource and an engine for our development, we need a policy framework which creates employment opportunities for them. If they get employed, what happens? Tomorrow when you start working, what will you do? You start getting a salary. The first thing perhaps you would do is buy good clothes, buy new mobiles, or buy a motorcycle or a car or whatever is your fancy. But then suddenly you will say that I need to save some money for the rainy day. And you start saving, you start putting aside a little. But when everybody who gets to work, that is this chunk of people, they start saving a little, the aggregate savings in the economy start rising and multiplying rapidly. And when that happens, the nation has the resources, the domestic resources available to engineer that fast transformation. And let me tell you, all countries that are now developed countries or are identified as developed countries became developed when they were going through this kind of transition. But what they did, they were successful in creating the employment opportunities for that rapidly rising workforce. Now that is our challenge in this region. That's a challenge in Nepal, that's a challenge in India. The other picture that you see here is showing the share of this plus this divided by the total population. So it is giving you the share of dependent population in the country. Now you see, in case of Nepal, it is declining. And this point when it is going to be the lowest is 2045. That means Nepal has a window of opportunity. We are already 2050. We have a window of opportunity of 3 decades to tap into that resource